The memories are still vivid. On May 29, 2016, disaster struck the village of Braunsbach in southwestern Germany.
I literally watched the flood, a wave of debris heading towards me. It made a noise. I couldn't figure out what it was exactly. Then I realized the whole house was shaking.
Braunsbach's mayor Frank Harsch filmed the catastrophe unfolding in front of him.
It's insane, completely insane. The emergency services can't do anything. That's impossible right now, out of the question. May God save Braunsbach. I was in shock. I couldn't even begin to process what I was seeing.
Although no lives were lost, the flood left the village devastated.
It's terrible. I'm speechless. I've never seen anything like it.
A few years later, Germany suffered the effects of a different kind of extreme weather. In 2018 and 2019, temperatures rose above 40 degrees Celsius in the summer. With no rain for months on end, rivers dried up. A disaster for the local environment and its inhabitants.
Last year, there was no rainfall here in the region for more than 70 days.
Then, in summer 2021, the Ahr Valley in western Germany was hit by flash flooding.
All of a sudden, we were confronted with issues that we'd always thought only affected somewhere else in the world, in places like Bangladesh.
Dramatic weather fluctuations have become commonplace. What does the future hold? And what do we need to do to cope with climate change? We begin our research in Winterburg in the Hunsrück region, an idyllic spot at the foot of the Sonwald forest. On June 5, 2021, 5 weeks before the flooding in the Ahr Valley, a summer storm wreaked havoc here. The picturesque village was overwhelmed, and Jürgen Baumann's home was among the many destroyed. He and his wife Marion will never forget that day. A traumatic experience that's etched in their memory. The basement was completely flooded. The couple had only just finished renovating their home and now had to start all over again from scratch. They own a heating installation business, so at least they could do a lot of the work themselves.
We just got everything finished in here. 5 or 6 years ago, we'd fitted the house out with external thermal insulation for energy efficiency and switched from fossil fuels to an air-to-water heat pump inside. We'd done the garden, too, and were actually looking forward to concentrating on other things.
It wasn't to be. After hours of torrential rainfall over the local forest hills, the village was hit by a deluge.
I can't get the images out of my head. I often look at the photos we took. It really got to me.
Marion Baumann still can't believe what happened. The Rhine and the Mosel often burst their banks. But villages that are nowhere near major rivers shouldn't be at risk of flooding. Locals simply weren't prepared. The Baumanns still haven't gotten over the experience.
I was terrified that the front door would break and the water would rush in. From upstairs, we could see the pressure building. We could see the door starting to give way.
The water was up to here. The entire yard was underwater.
Winterburg is situated in a valley in the Hunsrück Mountains. The village is nestled in the Zonwald forest, the source of the water that caused such damage. Forested landscapes have vast water storage capacity, soaking up heavy rainfall like a sponge. But in recent years, this has no longer been happening as efficiently as it used to. Bernhard Frauenberger is in charge of the local forestry service. He and his colleague Michael Fake are going to show us what the problem is. The flooding in Winterburg and other villages down in the valley is linked to the state of the forest. It's increasingly dry. Here, where they're digging, even the beech trees are showing signs of drought damage, and beeches aren't usually very sensitive. It actually rained a lot in the summer of 2021, but how much rain did the ground actually absorb? It soon transpires, not much at all.
Yep, you can see it's bone dry.
Has drought become a long-term problem?
Last year, there was no rainfall here in the region for more than 70 days. In the Kastellaun area, it didn't rain for over 100 days. By the 1st of August 2021, there was still a deficit of over 250 liters per square meter. Hard to imagine given the year's overall weather, but it goes to show how severe the lack of rainfall has been in the last 3 years.
As Frauenberger explains, there needs to be 2 months of steady rainfall, day and night, to make up for the drought of recent years. He also says that the forest needs to be managed differently. In the past, water used to be drained from the forest. These days, he and his team are laying pipes and digging trenches in the Zonwald in order to replenish the watershed and retain the water that collects on the logging roads. The aim is to ensure it seeps into the ground across the forest instead of flowing into the valley and causing the waterways there to burst their banks.
There are lots of streams here in the Zonwald, the Ellerbach, the Gräfenbach, and it was striking how quickly their water levels rose in just a short space of time here in the Zonwald. When it rained, a massive amount of water collected in a concentrated area. It was pretty frightening.
When the storm hit, the forest couldn't absorb the torrential rain. The logging roads were crippled and had to be rebuilt. Now, deeper trenches and larger pipes have been put in place to reroute heavy rainfalls to points in the forest where it can seep into the ground.
Wir erreichen damit, dass wir diese Abflussspitzen brechen können.
What that does is avert excessive runoff and allow groundwater to replenish. The water is distributed slowly and steadily across the forest floor, where it's absorbed. In terms of the local ecosystem, it means there's enough water to sustain the forest as a natural resource again.
Lebensqualität bzw. als Lebensgrundlage zur Verfügung steht.
Bernhard Frauenberger is planning to upgrade the whole forest this way. It's a small but significant way of helping to reduce the effects of extreme weather. The next stop on our research trip is in northern Germany. Every year, Hamburg hosts the Extreme Weather Congress. It brings together weather and climate researchers, as well as environmental activists. The event aims to reach as many people as possible, in the process, raising awareness of climate change and the need to act. An urgent priority not only for meteorologist Sven Plöger, but also politicians and the likes of Mojib Latif, one of Germany's leading climate researchers. The 2021 Congress was overshadowed by the events in the Ahr Valley.
Kann
We need change. The choice isn't between more or less climate protection, but between proper, radical, sustainable climate protection and climate disaster. That's where we're at.
There's Fridays for Future. And in 2019, there was more discussion of the climate and the environment than there's ever been before. But in 2019, that same year, before the pandemic hit, we also took more cruises and more flights than ever before. There's a huge cognitive dissonance going on. And if we really want to get anywhere, then we need to have the courage to change.
The experts attending the event are unanimous. Both drought and flooding will become increasingly common.
On the one hand, there are protracted dry spells, as we saw in 2018, 2019 and 2020, and these weren't balanced out. There's always been the occasional dry year, but three in a row is conspicuous. And on the other hand, we can expect to see increasingly frequent storms and heavy rainfall, very slow-moving storms, and flash flooding. In general, the weather is becoming more extreme. That's the bottom line.
While we were at the Congress, we heard about an ambitious research project looking at extreme weather in the Schwäbian Mountains. 10 German research institutes are pooling their resources, including cloud and precipitation radars and lasers, in order to explore the complex processes that occur in the atmosphere. Basic scientific research that allows them to better predict extreme weather events and their consequences. These scientists are waiting for stormy weather. The Swabian Alps are Germany's main storm hotspot, and storms are a key aspect of extreme weather. Professor Michael Kunz is a meteorologist.
We're going to blow up our balloons, so we'll be ready if a storm starts to brew. We've already set up the probes, so now we're going to load the balloons in the car, 6 or 7 of them, and then we'll drive right into the storm.
The balloons are filled with helium. They'll carry small probes into the clouds and will enable the scientists to observe hail formation occurring during the storm. Hail is a typical feature of extreme weather. The team are excited. The clouds are gathering. After hours of waiting, they now need to act fast. Before they head into the storm, Michael Kunz visits the lab to check the clouds' activity. Which direction are they drifting in? And is the upwind or convection strong enough to carry the probes into the storm clouds?
Convection ensures a powerful liftoff. When the rain forms, it falls more or less vertical to the point where the upwind is. Basically, it suppresses the upwind. And that means that the standard lifetime of a single cell is, on average, 30 minutes to an hour. It destroys itself, as it were.
That makes it all the more important to release the balloons in the right place at the right time. Outside, the storm cell is getting stronger. It's time for the scientists to launch their balloons. Right here. Positioned inside cups, the probes measure temperature and air pressure as the balloons drift upwards through the storm, precisely where hailstorms are forming inside the clouds. Michael Kunz can follow the action in real time.
We've got a signal.
We're going to use 3 balloons because the rain's got worse, and we hope they'll take off.
I've got a signal. Off we go. Lovely.
The probes are inside the clouds, taking the pulse of the storm, as it were.
Fortunately, we're not in the middle of the storm cell. There are 5-centimeter hailstones coming down. And they'd give our cars a good bashing.
From here, Michael Kunz and his team can collect a wealth of useful data that will help predict extreme weather events. We're planning to visit him in his lab in Karlsruhe in a few weeks' time. Back in Winterburg, the Baumanns are still dealing with the flood damage. It's the weekend, but instead of putting their feet up, they're hard at work trying to make their home livable again. Jürgen Baumann is haunted by memories of last July, when a gaping hole suddenly appeared in his yard.
There was a power cut because all the sockets were underwater. It was like being on a houseboat.
So what exactly happened?
Well, this here is an old stream tunnel, and there was so much pressure from underneath that it got pushed up. It's a self-supporting structure, and when it got pushed up, one stone breaks off and the structure collapses.
A film shot on his mobile phone shows the sinkhole that resulted, right in front of his house.
The hole in the garden got bigger. Then our solid wood garden bench got pulled into the current, turned in circles, and was washed away. That was the point when I said to my husband, OK, now I'm frightened.
It all disappeared into the hole. All the chairs, our terracotta ornaments, it all got washed away. What happened here was nothing in comparison to the disaster in the Ahr Valley. There was some damage. It's bad. It's a problem. But at least no one was hurt.
The Ahr Valley floods in July 2021 claimed 133 lives, with 700 people left injured and 42,000 others also affected. They were among the worst floods in German history. In the space of just a few hours, it rained as much as it usually does in months. The German Meteorological Service called it unprecedented. Insurance companies said it was the most expensive weather-related incident in 50 years, with damages totaling an estimated 10 billion euros. Does climate change mean that such events are likely to become more frequent? We meet up with geographers Thomas Roggenkamp and Theresa Steidl in the village of Maischoss in the Ahr Valley. They're trying to establish the precise water levels that occurred during the flooding. Not easy, given that many of the water gauges along the Ahr River got swept away. Experts rely on them to analyze and predict flood events.
Die Wasserstände, die erreicht wurden, oder auch die Abflüsse, die erreicht wurden, haben alles, was man bisher durch Pegelmessungen kannte, deutlich
The water levels on the outflow far exceeded any flooding that happened since records began. Fivefold. We haven't seen water levels like that in recent history. But if you look at the history of the Ahr Valley, then you can see that in fact these extreme events did occur. They were very rare, but not unknown. In 1804, there was flooding in the Ahr Valley that caused similar damage. Obviously on a smaller scale, because at that point, the valley was less built up.
Here in Maischoss, the storm swept away a number of houses and destroyed the local train line, complete with most bridges. Theresa Steidl and Thomas Roggenkamp from the University of Bonn are using a theodolite surveying tool to measure maximum flood heights across the valley. It helps them identify precise water levels at precise geographical locations. The brown color of this facade shows just how far the water rose. Thomas Roggenkamp has been researching the history of floods in the Ahr Valley for many years. This time, the water here was 10 meters higher than its normal level.
Es gibt auch Hochwasserrisikokarten, die flächendeckend für alle Flüsse vorliegen in Deutschland. Und
There are flood risk maps for all of Germany's rivers, but clearly they've not been adequate. On the basis of these maps, there are plenty of places where you could reasonably decide to put up new buildings. But these maps don't include historical floods. The water level records that are available date back just 50 or 60 years, and that's too short a time frame to reflect extreme events.
These maps have since been updated and now include historical data too. But what role did climate change play in the Ahr Valley disaster? Was that the ultimate cause?
I would argue that the scale of the flood is not necessarily climate change related, but in terms of the frequency, in other words, how often such events occur, you could argue that changing weather conditions mean that floods are now occurring more frequently, and that's a consequence of climate change.
Climate change increases the likelihood of such events occurring more frequently, as demonstrated by a recent study conducted with the participation of the German Meteorological Service. Yet the question remains, why is weather becoming more extreme? We meet Sven Plöger at the Weather Center of Germany's main public broadcaster. Some 35 forecasts are produced for weather bulletins here every day. Plöger's job includes analyzing maps and figures. The TV weatherman has observed that a number of weather phenomena have become increasingly common.
This here is a 50-knot wind.
Oh, okay.
Plöger tells us about the standing waves phenomenon. High pressure and low pressure fronts that don't actually move. It explains the devastating storms in the Ahr Valley, the Sonnwald, and Braunsbach. It's highly uncommon for high and low pressure fronts to be stationary, but it's become a feature of current weather patterns.
Storms that move distribute rain across a wider area. If they don't move, the impact is concentrated in one place, so there's extremely heavy rainfall. If the high pressure front doesn't move, then we have the high temperatures and drought we saw in 2003 or 2018. At the moment, we're seeing more frequent standing waves and also more frequent stationary highs and lows. So that's a hypothesis that's being investigated right now. In scientific terms, it's not straightforward. The natural world is always complex.
According to Plöger, climate change is exacerbating the frequency of standing waves of air. Meteorologist and storms researcher Michael Kunz agrees. We're meeting him at his research institute. He set up a center dedicated to analyzing natural disasters. He and his team evaluate extreme weather events around the world. They were among the first to compile an overview of the scale of the Ahr Valley disaster and the damage it caused. Michael Kunz shows us a map of the area based on satellite data and aerial images. He believes society needs to adjust to the prospect of frequent extreme weather events.
Extreme weather events occur in Germany every year. There are floods, hailstorms, winter storms. We live with them and we have to live with them. And we have to be aware that they happen and know how to respond. But we tend to ignore it, as is typical in our society. We ignore things we don't like, but that can be highly destructive, and then these disasters happen.
Und dann führt das eben zu solchen Ereignissen.
Kunz and his colleagues closely monitor the course and the consequences of these disasters. The aim is to figure out what we can learn from them, and in the meantime, to remain vigilant.
Im Idealfall sind das Ereignisse, aus denen wir für die Zukunft lernen können.
Ideally, these are events that can and should teach us lessons for the future. When floods occur, it's a mistake to say, okay, there's been a flood, it won't happen again that soon. Let's rebuild everything exactly the way it was. That's what's happening in the Ahr Valley. But we know now that places that were flooded are highly vulnerable.
Wir sehen das in den Überflutungsflächen, dass das halt schon wirklich Regionen sind, die hochsensitiv sind. Das kann sein.
Statistics don't tell us anything there. Another flood could happen next year, or it could happen in 200 years' time. But what we do know is that if such an extreme weather event happens again, then certain spots, such as Schult on the Ahr River, will most certainly be flooded again.
Michael Kunz and his team have also analyzed the flash flooding in Braunsbach in 2016. At the time, it was the most severe flooding seen in Germany for decades. Again, the cause was extremely heavy rainfall concentrated in one area. Within 30 minutes, the village was torn apart. Miraculously, no one died, but many were left homeless. It also resulted in an unusually vast volume of flotsam and other debris.
It's terrible. I'm speechless. I've never seen anything like it.
The reconstruction work still isn't finished. And for locals, the emotional scars have yet to heal. Mayor Frank Harsch helped steer the village through its darkest hour. The road to recovery has been strewn with obstacles and setbacks. Harsch has even encountered hostility. It's been a difficult few years. He's written a book about what happened and travels the country giving talks on the environmental threats facing villages like Braunsbach, featuring images such as these.
The images are so affecting, they inevitably move people deeply. You couldn't reach them the same way with words. The images are extremely powerful. We are still dealing with the consequences. The reconstruction work is ongoing. 5 years later, we can't do everything at once. It'll take a few more years before we're done. It's a long-term process. We have to think in terms of decades. We have to think about how to contain flooding, how to treat the ground, what to do to protect the places at higher altitude where there's heavy rainfall.
The village's main square was completely rebuilt. The mayor wants to show us other reconstruction work, such as the new reinforced walls along the village stream. The reconstruction work has cost the village approximately 55 million euros to date. Outside the village, there are now massive debris traps along the narrow slope. For Frank Harsch, this is a key element in the protection plan. The huge structure is designed to trap avalanches of debris pouring downstream.
Weiter oben, sozusagen flussaufwärts, ca. 50 Meter, kommt nochmal ein riesen dynamischer.
About 50 meters upstream, there's another huge debris trap. What we have to do, and it's a long-term project, is try to hold back the water at the source where the heavy rainfall occurs. It could be a retention reservoir, which is problematic up there. And it would be better if the water could seep into the ground. To me, the best solution would be to stop farming practices and plant more trees to improve seepage potential.
The land around Braunsbach is extensively farmed. Field boundaries were removed that could have helped contain water. And there are fields and fields of corn. Another detrimental factor, because the crop dries out the soil.
Also ein vertrockneter Boden kann eben das Wasser nicht gut aufnehmen und deswegen
arid soil can't absorb water, and that results in localized flooding. I like to compare it to baking cake dough. Imagine taking some flour and pouring milk on it. The flour is the dry ground, the milk the heavy rain. What you'll be left with is flour on the bottom and milk just floating on top. Once you start kneading and the bottom, in this case the flour, has been moistened with a little bit of milk, you can add more milk and it'll soak in better.
An aspect we'd like to investigate further. At the University of Trier, researchers are finding out how drought changes soil. An experiment is underway in the soil science department, with samples being examined to see how well they absorb water.
Soil acts like a sponge in the landscape, storing water over a long period of time and then gradually releasing it to plants, to its surroundings, to lakes and rivers. Extreme weather brought about by climate change has consequences. Dry soil can't absorb water at the same rate. Instead, water just runs off it, leading to flooding in bodies of water and also to soil erosion.
The soil scientists want to demonstrate how long it takes a drop of water to seep into various soil samples. First, they add a drop of blue-colored water to completely dry soil. It takes a while for the drop of blue water to be absorbed. The soil is so dry, it's become impermeable.
I've got two more samples. What have you found out so far?
The soil samples are very different. The dryness definitely plays a big role.
Once good soil containing humus is parched, it takes days to moisten again. A cross-check clearly shows that soil that isn't completely dried out can still soak up water.
When I was a student in the 80s and 90s, we didn't see this kind of dry subsoil. It was unimaginable, but that's what we're dealing with now. The Environmental Research Center's drought monitor shows that soil at depths of up to 1.8 meters has dried out massively, and the rainfall we're experiencing in 2021 is just about managing to replenish the topsoil with the water supply it needs. But the subsoil is still parched by the drought of the last 3 years.
Dry subsoil and flooding. Not as contradictory as it sounds, according to the experts. The drought of 2018 resulted in reduced harvests and millions of euros worth of losses in Germany's agricultural sector. Rivers dried up, such as the Dreisam near Freiburg, which flows from the Black Forest. Industry struggled with a shortage of raw materials, and even gas was in short supply. The media was full of doomsday scenarios.
In my opinion, it's a mistake to focus on all the doom and gloom when the media goes on about the apocalypse and this crisis and that crisis. We end up so overwhelmed that we lose all our courage and think there's no point trying to do anything about it, when in fact there are so many groundbreaking projects.
Groundbreaking projects that prove we're not powerless against extreme weather, such as the Lebensberg Organic Farm on the Donnersberg Hill Range in Rheinland-Pfalz, founded by young people. But it relies on water, and that's in short supply up here. Janine Rabe works to ensure the soil is as permeable as possible. So long as it can still absorb water, it can withstand extreme rainfall fluctuations.
2014 gab es hier in der Region auch starke Hochwasser.
In 2014 there was severe flooding here in the region that caused millions worth of damage. The Moschelbach stream overflowed. Most of the areas around it are agricultural fields that are compacted and where the water can't seep in easily. The soil is humus deficient. Flooding sweeps away the entire topsoil and entire villages are hit by mudslides.
The young organic farmers are planning to revitalize their land using a special technique. First, they analyze local rainfall patterns. The blue lines on the chart show in which direction the rainfall is likely to flow. Janine Rabe and her colleague have drawn red lines where they plan to dig ditches that will help distribute the water across the farmland. This technique is called key line water management. But they're concerned about the amount of red in their chart, which indicates just how dry the region is. They're keen to show us how effective their strategy is against weather extremes. First, they use a hoe to dig their ditches before switching to an excavator. They want to test how the key line water system works. They dig their trenches with a slight gradient, 1.5%, to prevent large volumes of water from flowing too fast.
We're conducting an experiment to illustrate how the water that amasses during heavy rainfall events can be distributed over the area and can seep into the ditches laid according to the key line system, instead of flowing down the slope and causing flooding in the valleys.
The water from the topographical depressions, where it collects, can be diverted to the mound, where the ground is driest.
Janine Rabe uses a water tank and a hose to simulate heavy rainfall. A mock mini flood. Obviously, rain is less localized. But the experiment shows that the ditch absorbs the artificial downpour as planned. The water then flows along the key line towards the elevation. It looks simple, but it's an intelligent way for farming to adjust to the challenges of climate change. But heavy rainfall and drought don't just adversely affect rural regions, but urban areas too. Villages, towns, and cities also need to adjust, says weather expert Sven Plüger.
Das Problem ist natürlich auch, dass Stadt und Umland sich massiv unterscheiden durch diese unglaubliche Versiegelung.
The problem, of course, is that cities and surrounding areas are very different because cities are built up. Studies show that heat waves in the likes of Cologne and Frankfurt make them 9 degrees hotter than surrounding areas. Cities such as Karlsruhe are also likely to see a significant increase in temperature. And this poses an additional problem. It effectively makes the city a completely different climate zone. So we need to think about how we can make cities greener and less dry. With more greenery, more water, cooling by evaporation to curb extreme heat.
Urban planners in Karlsruhe are already looking at ways the city can tackle climate change. One of their first projects is the redesign of the plaza outside the main station. It's set to become much greener, which will not only make it more attractive, but also help protect the city from getting too hot.
In unseren Städten gibt es wahnsinnig viele versiegelte.
Our cities are very built up. The idea is that instead of being drained off to rivers, leading to flooding, water is retained in the cities. That's what's called a sponge city.
Das nennt man eigentlich eine Schwammstadt.
Florian Otto is a landscape architect and urban planner. His Munich-based team was awarded the redesign contract. Construction is about to begin.
Wir haben immer mehr Hitzetage.
We're experiencing more very hot days, but also more heavy rainfall. That's problematic enough in the countryside, but it's even more extreme in the cities. It can get unbearably hot in cities like Karlsruhe in the Rhine Valley. We have to cool down our cities and at the same time mitigate the heavy rainfall, which is becoming more frequent, and retain the water in the cities.
Abzumildern, um das Wasser zurückzuhalten.
Trees, fountains, and mist spray will help cool the plaza while the walkways are permeable. Water is a key design element.
We need to use every project to boost water retention in cities, for plants, for cooling purposes. We need to convert cities to what's called green and blue infrastructure.
Karlsruhe is adopting the sponge city concept to meet the climate change challenges of the future. Innovation is essential. Forester Bernhard Frauenberger in the Sonwald is also looking for creative ways of maximizing water retention. Just like Florian Otto in Karlsruhe, his aim is to capture, distribute, and use water as efficiently as possible.
What's crucial is that we make the core function of the forest the focus of our efforts, to boost water retention and increase its sponge function.
Wie können wir genau diese Schwammfunktion steigern?
There are grounds for optimism. We just need to adapt to changing weather patterns. That's what Braunsbach Mayor Frank Harsch tells people as he tours Germany raising awareness of flash floods.
We need action and improvement across the board, and I do believe that can work.
But a lot needs to happen before people like Jürgen and Marion Baumann are safe from the threat of flooding in the villages of Winterburg, Braunsbach, and elsewhere. After a lot of hard work, the couple have almost finished rebuilding their home.
Yes, finally. We're making progress and we'll soon be done.
The underfloor heating has just been installed. Now the million-dollar question. Where will the couch go?
You asking me or my wife?
We'll leave that to them to figure out. But the couple did agree on tiling the floor. Tiles are more water resistant, just in case.